Tiga, dua,
ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon from Jakarta and a good evening to everyone joining us from Delhi. Welcome to FPCI's Up Close and Personal series, where today we will have a conversation with Nobel laureate Jose Ramos Horta titled Timor Leste, Hard Lessons from the Past, High Hopes for the Future. Welcome, Pak Jose Ramos Horta. It's good to see you. All right, so today's discussion will be moderated by FPCI founder and chairman, Dr. Dino Patijalal. Hello, Pak Dino. And we also want to give a warm welcome to our distinguished guests here today. We have the ambassadors to Indonesia, Ambassador Yasoja Gunasekera from Sri Lanka. We have Ambassador Peter Andonov from Bulgaria, Ambassador Gustavo Ayares of Chile, Ambassador Yaroslav Shlevo from Slovakia, Ambassador Armando Gonzalo Alvarez Reina from Mexico, and Ambassador Faisal Azaki from Afghanistan. We also have the ambassadors, Ambassador Noel Servigot of the Philippines, Ambassador to ASEAN. We have Ambassador Herman Gildo Lopez of Timor-Leste to Cambodia. And lastly, we have Ambassador Andrew Jacobs, EU Ambassador to Fiji and the Pacific. Welcome, Your Excellencies.
Thank you.
We also have participants tuning into our discussion from all over the world, not just from Indonesia and Timor-Leste, but also from the Philippines, from Malaysia, Singapore, Cambodia, Myanmar, Australia, US, UK, Japan, Netherlands, France, Finland, Saudi Arabia, Mexico, Mauritius, Chile, and many, many more. So thank you to all the participants who joined today. So before we begin our discussion today, please enjoy the following video by FPCI. hope you enjoyed the video that we had. Now, ladies and gentlemen, today we will listen to a very interesting conversation regarding Pak Jose Ramos Horta's views on ASEAN, on Ukraine, on Rohingya and Myanmar, on major power rivalries, and on Timor-Leste's presidential elections. So without further ado, may I invite our moderator for today, FPCI founder and chairman, Dr. Dino Patijalal. Pak Dino, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Cindy. And by the way, congratulations. Cindy has just recovered from Omicron, right? Just tested negative just 2 days ago. So welcome back, Cindy. And I want to welcome all the ambassadors who are here and viewers from 36 countries. Yeah, so welcome. I also want to welcome two people who will also ask questions to Jose Ramos Horta, Prisia Nasution, who is a cultural icon, an actress in Indonesia, award-winning actress. And then later on, hi, Prisia, how are you? Yes, good. And then later on, we will have another cultural icon, the art actress, Christine Hakim, who will join us in the second half of the hour. They are both friends of Jose Ramos Horta, and I'm very pleased to be here. Today, we are very fortunate and honored to have with us an old friend of mine, Dr. Jose Ramos Horta. And I have to tell you, this is an interesting, for those who don't know, this is an interesting meeting between me and Jose Ramos Horta, because I'll be very honest with you, he was my opponent. In fact, he was my enemy. I kid you not, you know, when I was a junior diplomat, I had the East Timor desk, and my job was to handle East Timor affairs. We call it Timor-Timor back then. And he was on the opposite side, obviously, and we considered him the enemy, right? But this is how wonderful the world is. Today, he's not just a friend, but he's a brother to me. We call each other all the time. I've been to his home. In fact, we regard him as a family. Yeah, and he knows that very well. But more than that, he's actually also a customer. My wife has a dental office, and my wife knows every inch of his teeth. His mouth, right? Because he's a customer and very good customer, you know. So look forward to meeting him many more times. But it's really an honor to know an incredible person. He used to be the president of Timor-Leste. He won the Nobel Peace Prize in 2006. Sorry, in 1996. He was also Minister for Foreign Affairs, Prime Minister also for Timor-Leste. He chaired the UN High-Level Panel on Peace Operations. He was the special rep and head of a UN Integrated Peacebuilding Office in Guinea-Bissau. He's really a rare breed, you know, an extraordinary person, a great diplomat, a dedicated peacemaker, and most of all, an extraordinary son of Timor-Leste. So with that, I would like to invite Dr. Ramos Horta, who, by the way, for Indonesians who are not aware, is running in the presidential elections, which is coming this Saturday. You know, I wish I could be there to watch the elections. We have a habit of visiting elections in some ASEAN countries, I'm sure it's going to be a peaceful and successful elections. Yeah. So best of luck to you, Dr. Ramos Horta, and also other candidates. And let me invite you to have your opening remarks, and then we'll follow up with a conversation. Yeah. Please, Dr. Horta.
Thank you, Dino, for once again hosting me. Some time ago, you and I co-host the Myanmar Forum in April last year, and I have participated with you in other forums, like in Jakarta itself, 3 years ago. And so thank you for this platform once again. I thank Patricia for joining, and Christine Hakim, Dr. Rosa for joining, and all the staff of foreign policy community in Indonesia for doing such a remarkable initiative, and that is becoming a huge success across Southeast Asia. We, our people, are going to vote this Saturday. We have many international observers, in particular large delegation observers from the CPLP countries, the community of Portuguese-speaking countries. They are here, and actually the head of the delegation is in this room. And in this room there are many invited guests, many Timorese, members of parliament, members of government, and so on. They're all here. And we have been covered by our Metro TV and network. And so far, the campaign period and prior to the official campaign period and during this period, it has been remarkably peaceful, except for some incidents that primarily involve not the CNRT, not me, my campaign, but involve other campaigns, particularly and strangely enough, between two parties that are in the current coalition government. Some physical violent incidents and so on, but minor in the scale of the situation in Timor-Leste. A question might be asked, and I have been asked, why after 10 years absent from politics, of active engagement, why I decide to run again? Well, although we are rated by Freedom House in Washington, or because we are rated by Freedom House in Washington as the best functioning democracy in Southeast Asia, my apologies to the Indonesian friends, but yeah, we are actually rated number one. Number two is Indonesia. At least once we are beating Indonesia on this. But because of that, but because of our own strong belief, adherence to what we have. You know, we might not be a rich country, we are not. We might not be good in doing many things, but our people have a profound adherence to the freedom that we want, to the democracy that we want to establish here. So any leader who appears to be, and worse than appearing to be, that actually engage in practices that violate the sacred principles of our own constitution has a strong reaction. The reaction obviously is not violent. Our people have been incredibly patient for the last 3 years, witnessing the outgoing president. I'm saying outgoing because even if he's elected, well, he's outgoing from the current term, he's running again, where the president committed a direct affront to our constitution. What is our constitution? We have a political system that is called semi-presidential system. It is not similar to Singapore, Fiji, or other situations whereby the president is actually, without offense, the figurehead. It is semi-presidential system, similar to the one in Portugal, in Cape Verde, in Israel, it's similar, whereby the president has certain powers. But in the semi-presidential system, the executive authority, the executive powers rest with the prime minister. Unlike in Indonesia, United States, Philippines, where you have a presidential system, the president is actually the executive authority. What happened during the last few years? The president exceeded his powers established in the Constitution, whereby he is obliged to invite the leader of the most voted party, the most voted party, or the leader of a majority alliance, having consulted with members in the parliament, to be the prime minister and swearing him and to form the government. The government is formed from the majority in the parliament, because it's the parliament that make it viable, any government. And that is our system. However, the leader of the coalition in 2018 election was our brother, Mr. Xanana Gusmão, whom all of you know, everyone knows around the region, in the world, charismatic, revered by our people. So he was the leader. However, he ceded prime ministership to Taul Matarua, former president, former head of the army. And they presented a cabinet list to the president. Under our constitution, the president simply swear in the prime minister, which he did, and swear in the cabinet. That's all he has to do, all he can do. However, the president, who is also president of the Fretilin party, decided not to swear in 7 cabinet members from CNRT party and 2 from Kuntu party, member of the coalition. So that's what set in motion a series of continuing violation of the constitution, exceeding his powers. I watched from outside. I advise the current president, please, this is not your authority. You cannot do that. So then the situation went on. He violated second time, third time, and our people remained incredibly patient. So, but then there is a movement pushed me to run for president. It took me 2 years since the first contact was made to me. And I accepted when Mombot Xanana, in English it's called our older brother, we call Mombot, approached me, his party, and asked me to run for president again. So here I am. We celebrating on the 20th of May, as we inaugurate the new president, midnight 19th May, we celebrate the 20th anniversary since the independence that was celebrated worldwide with the president of Bill Clinton, prime minister of Australia, president, prime minister of Portugal, secretary general of the UN, the late Kofi Annan, and Ibu Mega from Indonesia also was present in our celebration, May 20, 2002. So it has been 2 years of democratic experiment that has been actually lauded, defined as dynamic, one of the best. And we live peacefully. Timor-Leste remains an oasis of tranquility in Southeast Asia and in Asia. We don't have a ethnic base, religious base conflicts, zero. We have an incredible, successful policy of national reconciliation. And as you know, with Indonesia as well. And all of this has been inspired, guided by Mombot Xanana Gusmão. And under Xanana Gusmão government, 2007-2017, he was the leader of this coalition. The country has seen extraordinary economic growth. At some point, we had 13% growth. Average was 8-9%. And mushrooming of infrastructures, of business, of trade, and so on. And finally, to end my remarks here, we are on the eve, and I say eve doesn't mean tomorrow, I say on the eve, it can be next year or 2 years' time, in joining ASEAN. And again, I want to say here in sincere appreciation to our friends in Indonesia, past presidents and current, started with Gus Dur, whom I knew when he was, when I was sometime in Paris in the 80s, Gus Dur was there and we met. So Gus Dur came to Timor-Leste, then Ibu Mega came, and then our great friend Susilo Bambang Widiono came three times, I think, at least three times. And I have met with Susilo SBE a number of times. And President Jokowi came. I met President Jokowi in Jakarta, I think more than once in different capacities, not as president, because by the time Jokowi was was elected, was already former president, and I met in different circumstances. So we have exceptionally good relationship, more or less, in Indonesia, and the two countries are an inspiring example to others in the region, in Southeast Asia, in Asia in general, and even in the Middle East, where I have been to more than once, in Israel, in Jordan, in Lebanon. And when I speak about Timor-Leste Indonesia relationship, everybody is surprised in the Middle East. And so it is a very positive note in that regard. Our people are going to vote Saturday. If I win, it means I will carry a heavy wooden cross supported by tens of thousands of people in this country, and I hope the international community, to restore the constitutional principles and practices in our country. And then for the next 5 years, working with the government that I hope it will be led by Mombotsa Nana Gusmão, we will do a jumpstart our economy. A bit later on, I'm happy to talk more about ASEAN membership, about economics, about security in the region, etc.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Horta. And we wish you all the best for your elections on this coming Saturday. And please send my best regards also to Sanana Gusmão. He is well-loved by many in Indonesia. And I think there's no doubt that you're joining the presidential race this year raises the quality of the elections campaign. So best of luck from us. I want to ask you a question about, Indonesia and Timor-Leste had a very difficult and painful and even bitter history. As I told you, we consider each other enemies, in the past, our adversaries, opposing sides. But it's also a rare place where both sides reconcile. They got together in a forward-looking and positive mindset and change their relationship, right? And that doesn't happen any too often around the world. In many places, conflicts remain there, even though there was a political solution, and hatred and resentment is passed on to generations. I'm just wondering, from your side, what do you think went right in terms of Indonesia, Timor-Leste relations? Because every time I went there after the referendum, there was no hatred. There was no, want revenge and things like that from what I saw. Yeah. But what do you think happened? How did it happen?
I would say, throughout the course of the struggle for independence, never once Timorese resistance leaders ever attempted to demonize Indonesia as a people, or demonize Islam, being Indonesia's largest majority Muslim country in the world. Because in some situation, like in the Balkans, with the conflict in Serbia, Kosovo, and many others, political leaders use sometimes very old, centuries old history to demonize the other side. The genocide in Bosnia committed by Serbia, led by Milosevic, they went back and dig up problems that happened 800 years ago and demonize the Kosovo, the Muslims, the Bosnians, and we end up with a genocide. In Rwanda, it's the same. It was political leaders, even some religious leaders. Well, in our case, even in the wars of the time during the struggle for independence, never any leader tried to demonize. So the people were not brainwashed, were not conditioned to think evil about people. And besides, when Shanana was detained in 1992 and served 7 years, 8 years in prison in Jakarta, Sipinang, Shanana being Shanana, super charismatic, he won over all the sympathy of the Indonesian media, even during the Suharto era of the Indonesian people. And as he himself, he told once, he learned to love Indonesian people, Indonesia in prison in Indonesia. With his incredible authority that derives from his leadership of the struggle and his personality, he is one who led our people first national reconciliation, which has been also tremendously successful, and the reconciliation with Indonesia. On the other side, the Indonesian side responded with, I would say that word I find is in French, with hauteur, and with a height, you know, with a show of statesmanship of mature country, mature society, in that Indonesia didn't turn around and say, you know, you want independence, so be it, and turn its back on us. Quite the opposite, Indonesia responded, walked halfway. And so this is what admirable about to, this relationship, more or less, in Indonesia. And every time I go to Indonesia, I'm always incredibly welcome, not only by the political leaders, but also by the military and by people in the hotel lobby. Sometimes I walk a bit in the street of Jakarta, and incredible the friendliness towards me. Of course, not to say towards Shanana, you know. So that is the explanation for this, our first tremendously successful national healing, national reconciliation, and second, the normalization of relations with Indonesia.
Can I ask a follow-up question on that? I remember very well when I was in government, one of the very sensitive issue was the call by international groups for an international tribunal for people who were involved in the violence in the 1999 referendum, and also those who were involved in previous human rights violations in East Timor. What I found was a turning point was when your side, Shanana Gusmao and yourself and others decided not to go that route, not to press for international tribunal, but to form a bilateral commission on justice and friendship to address these problems, right? I'm for historical record, I found this, you know, quite amazing. What was your reasoning? What can you walk us through your line of thinking on how that thinking process evolved? Yeah.
Well, one, I remember Shanana said once, if we want to start a judicial process, where shall we start? Should we start with the civil war in Timor-Leste, where we ourselves where no one else were engaged. Should we also look into the crimes perpetrated by Fretlin during the struggle, within the range of Fretlin itself, and many other violations? Or we are just going to try the ex-militias, and so he was, he said something along these lines. But the fundamental question is, we understood the challenge Indonesia faced in the post-Suharto era, in transitioning to democracy, in trying to heal the wound in Indonesia itself among Indonesians, and any attempt by the international community to impose international tribunal would not help the transition process in Indonesia to democracy. It would exacerbate political situation in Indonesia. And I personally had strong arguments with Kofi Annan, later with Ban Ki-moon, with Colin Powell in Washington, with many in the US Congress, because we have many friends in the US Congress, like Patrick Leahy, Senator Patrick Leahy, who you know, and many others, who were surprised why we were not in favor of a special tribunal. And I explained along these lines. And of course, in Timor-Leste, the vast majority of the people, they follow the leadership, and Janana and me and others. But there are some NGOs who were not in favor of a, not supporting international tribunal, but that is okay. We have a diversity of thinking in this country. Not everybody thinks the same, more or less, not North Korea, where everybody thinks the same. So, but the prevailing sentiment, desire in the country is, we look back to honor the heroes and the martyrs. That's what we do. We look back to honor them. We don't look back to seek reasons for revenge and exclusion. And that's what prevailed. But in Timor-Leste, we opted for two mechanisms. One purely national, modeled on the South African reconciliation led by Desmond Tutu, the late Desmond Tutu, blessed by Mandela. And the other was unique in the world, where two countries that were engaged in a conflict, Timor-Leste and Indonesia, officially agree on a joint truth and reconciliation commission. Our was called Truth and the Friendship Commission. Five people, eminent from Indonesia, appointed by Indonesia president, five from Timor-Leste, appointed by our president. So we started this very unique process that we follow a two-track approach, national reconciliation, ours, and with Indonesia, and both have been tremendously successful. Of course, there are still maybe some sentiments, grievances, but you know, Indonesian citizens who are here, are thousands of Indonesian citizens who are in Timor-Leste, they are best witnesses to the success. It is not a pure formality declaration on reconciliation, no. It is a true reconciliation that Indonesians feel in Timor-Leste and Timorese feel in Indonesia.
Yeah, thank you. I think that was an important statement that you just made for historical record. Let me now turn to ASEAN. And by the way, I want to say hello to another good friend, your ambassador in Cambodia, Hermenegildo Lopez. I should tell you, when I was my first posting in London, I think 1995 or so, you know, I was on the second floor of my embassy, and I had people storming my embassy, like jumping into the second floor and banging on the door, on the windows, you know. I thought, oh my God, we're being attacked. And one of them was Ambassador Hermen Naguildo, right? He was a very, very active activist, East Timor activist. And now he's ambassador to Cambodia and also my good friend. So it's nice to see you, Ambassador Lopez. Yeah. Now, let me turn to ASEAN. And I'm just wondering, you know, you mentioned that East Timor-Leste is going to be joining ASEAN. But, you know, I also was part of the team that really pushed hard for Timor-Leste to join ASEAN. And it wasn't easy, as you know. You know, it was very painfully slow. There was some resistance, a lot of questions and so on. Were you surprised at how difficult it has been for Timor-Leste to join ASEAN? And also, can you tell us why does Timor-Leste want to join ASEAN?
I tell you one thing, you know, in 1974, I went to Jakarta, my first trip to Jakarta. I was only 25 or 24, I don't remember exactly when in 74, how old I was, probably like 25, 24. I went to Kupang first and I met up with Gubernur Brigadier General El Tari, whom I knew and became friends during the Portuguese time. And I had no money. Arriving in Kupang, El Tari, whom I had known, he liked me. He got me tickets to travel to Jakarta. And he sent one of his advisors, Luis Tacoli. I remember El Tari was telling Luis in front of me, Luis, you're going with Pak Ramos, look after him. Well, when I arrived in Jakarta, Luis Tavoli disappeared, and he went and joined Jakarta. I was left alone, but actually I was not alone. I was supported by Agus Parengwan, a Compass journalist, Hari Kavilaran, Sinan Arapan, and Saban Siachian, who gave me money in Jakarta. I went to see Pak Malik. I managed to see Pak Malik. I don't even remember how I managed to see Pak Malik. I went on a scooter. Can you imagine going to meet the foreign minister, famous Adam Malik, on a scooter? I end up meeting three times with Pak Malik. I don't go much into that. During the discussion, I already discussed with Pak Malik the future independent Timor-Leste would join ASEAN. And Pak Malik responded, yes, after independence, send your people to Deplu to be trained here. So this is a dream of a quest of joining ASEAN going back to the mid-70s. Of course, independence came in 2002. And at the time, I was foreign minister. So I already made approaches in that regard. But then formal application was done in 2011. Yes, it has taken that long. And I remember talking with some Singaporean official, particularly I remember way back talking with Prime Minister Kwok Chap Thong, later with Prime Minister Lee and so on. And Singapore, being Singapore, very pragmatic, and they are not negative. They are just being very pragmatic. And in retrospect, Singapore was right that it is not only a matter that Timor is entitled to join ASEAN. Of course, we are entitled by geography. We are part of Southeast Asia. One of the criteria for joining ASEAN is being part of Southeast Asia. The other criteria is that the country applying member is not member of other regional organizations. That particular clause was introduced by Indonesia itself because at that all these years, there have been other countries trying to join ASEAN. Papua New Guinea, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, I don't know who else, but this country. And there were some arguments by some why Timor and not Papua New Guinea and what and not Sri Lanka or Bangladesh. Well, precisely, they are not part of Southeast Asia. And they are already members of other regional organizations. Papua New Guinea, the Pacific Forum, and the others, Sri Lanka and Bangladesh, member of South Asia Regional Organization. So Timor-Leste, part of Southeast Asia, and is not member of any other regional organization. So that means we have we fulfill all the requirements. But this is not enough, and in this regard, I would say Singapore is right, because we know the burden of meetings, of responsibility that come from being a member of ASEAN. From my counting, there are 800 to more than 1,000 meetings a year. So we join ASEAN. It is our right to join, but right comes with responsibilities to deliver it on our own responsibility. So this delay, in my view, is, I think, has been very fruitful, was wise. And since then, we have made tremendous progress. There has been ASEAN assessment mission to Timor-Leste. If it were not for COVID, other missions would have come. We have hosted at least one ARF meeting or two ARF meetings successfully. More than 100 ASEAN officials came here during the time from the actual officials and their staff. So we are basically just now waiting for that timing. Can be 2022, 23, 24. And I have to say again, Indonesia, particularly under President Susilo Bambang Widodo, when the issue of Timor-Leste joining ASEAN has been was very forcefully pushed by President Susilo and the court approved. This remains the position of Indonesia, but Malaysia, also very supportive, very vocal, Cambodia, Philippines, Thailand is very vocal, and all other ASEAN countries. So now there is no reticence reservation from anyone.
Yeah, thank you. Let's move to Myanmar. Yeah, you and I, together, we hosted the NGO summit right after the coup in Myanmar. And I remember at that time, we were very skeptical about the possibility of elections or return to democracy in Myanmar. And I think all our predictions or concerns came true. Yeah. Until now, there are no clear path to return Myanmar to democracy. Yeah. I'm just wondering, what is your take on this? Why has the military in Myanmar having a very difficult time to retire from politics? As in the case of Indonesia, the military now is 100% out of politics, right? But that doesn't seem to happen in Myanmar. In fact, they return in full force to politics, and they seem to have no appetite or little understanding of what democracy is. So what's the end game? How do you think all this will play out, especially now that Aung San Suu Kyi has been sentenced to jail, and more charges are coming, and more of her supporters, the pro-democracy politicians, are under trial. Yeah.
I know Myanmar very well. I know Suu Kyi very well, and many others in Myanmar, going back more than 30 years. I first went to Myanmar illegally in July 1994. So in July 1994, going through Thailand, Chiang Mai, and then by boat up the river, and landed in Karen territory. To do what? To conduct a two-week training program in human rights and diplomacy for more than 100 people from across Myanmar, NLD and all the ethnic groups. That's what I was doing. Lecturing on the UN human rights system, the treaty bodies. I lectured on the techniques, on lobbying, not only lobbying the UN, lobbying the US Congress, and so on. I was almost arrested by, when I went back to Thailand, almost arrested by the Thai authorities, because by then they knew I had entered Thailand legally, but I left illegally. I mean, I went through, not through the formal border. Anyway, so I know the country well. Over the years, I followed the situation there. And went to Myanmar as former president several times. Always had meetings with Suu Kyi. I gave public lectures in Myanmar more than once. And what I would say is that first, remarkable, the resilience of the people of Myanmar, extraordinary, the widespread resistance to the military coup by the people, and the people very disappointed with the international community, and understandably. But also, I'm very pleased to see Indonesia, Singapore, Malaysia, Philippines, particularly leading the process to restore democracy in Myanmar, which shows the changes in Southeast Asia. It showed the changes in Indonesia, in Malaysia, even Singapore. And I was very pleasantly surprised and congratulate Indonesia for the moral, political, diplomatic leadership on Myanmar. And of course, I also commend Prime Minister Lee for the courageous stance taken by Singapore, because Singapore has invested tens of billions of dollars in Myanmar when democracy was restored in 2015. And the billions of dollars from Myanmar invested in Singapore. And yet, in spite of that, it didn't stop Singapore from taking an ethical stance in condemning the coup. We all know how difficult it is, the situation in Myanmar. If it were easy, it would have been resolved already. But I guarantee that in the end, the Myanmar military has to back down for their own survival. Take lessons from Indonesia transition to democracy. The fear of the military in Myanmar is that changes in Myanmar would mean many military leaders would end up in an international tribunal or in a domestic tribunal and jail and lose all their economic interests that are vast.
Okay.
Eventually, I hope that the ASEAN leadership, diplomacy, will succeed in persuading the Myanmar military to back down and release Suu Kyi and all political leaders. And only then, upon releasing Suu Kyi and other political leaders, then do mediation negotiations. The initial phases of the negotiation doesn't have to be direct, face-to-face. There is a so-called proximity talks, whereby the parties in conflict, they don't actually meet, but there is one envoy, whether ASEAN envoy or whether it is the UN, who go from city to city or go from hotel to hotel. The parties involved in the conflict, they stay in different hotels, they don't meet yet face to face. And that's what's called the proximity talks. It can start like that. But Myanmar authorities have first to honor their agreement, their respect, the implementation of the 5 points issued by ASEAN and the military leaders. Other than that, we just have to be very patient and persistent.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm going to give the floor to Prisia Nasution, who wants to ask you questions. And after that, I'm going to ask you about Ukraine. So I'm sure people will be interested in your comments on that. Prisia, please.
Hi. Yeah. Hello, Pat Horta. How are you? Last time we met was on 2019, wasn't it? December 2019, slightly before pandemic, before we know that, you know, we have to do meetings over Zoom like this and we cannot meet in person. And yeah, that was during conference of on Indonesian foreign policy. And that time I just got back from a motorbike riding from all the way to Flores until border of Timor Leste, which is Atambua. And so after that, I had an informal conversation with Pak Horta talking about it. You know, it was a mixed feeling when I ride my motorbike there, was because the kids are all waving until all the way to the border because they cannot cross the border to Atambua. And for me, it was also quite sad because we landed there at 5 and the border closed at 5. It was not as simple as probably way back then anymore, as we were still in one country. And as me and Pak Horta was talking about it, I personally believe that you have a strong ethos on public service because you were really also concerned about that. And but my question right now is, how can we convince young people today of the merit of devoting themselves to good cause and not for material gains?
Can you repeat the question because of the echo? I cannot hear it properly.
Okay.
Just the question.
Yeah. How can you convince young people today of the merit of devoting themselves to good cause and not for material gains?
Well, you know, we all say that young people. The young people are the engines of change, and that is largely true. We saw it in Indonesia, not only in 1998-99, but we saw it during the 60s in Indonesia. We have seen it across Europe over the last many decades. But young people, when young, we are full of ideals, we are full of demands, then all of us cease to be young gradually, and some are confronted with the realities of a particular given situation, and some give up on their dream when they were young, others not. We, in our case, you know, we were all in our 20s when we began forming the idea of an independent East Timor and pursue it for 24 years and since. In regard to Myanmar, again, allow me to go back to that. When the problem in Myanmar happened, I called Dino right away and I say, Indonesian society and societies across Southeast Asia have a responsibility to take action, to do something, because this is happening in the heart of Southeast Asia, in the heart of ASEAN. It must matter to people in Southeast Asia. And I wouldn't say the first initiative in Southeast Asia, because there were already some NGOs in the Philippines, Thailand, and across like Korea, Japan, and others, but in a major organized way, it was the first public forum, and mostly, again, young people. And but I have to say that unfortunately, there has not been a mass movement in Southeast Asia in solidarity with the people of Myanmar. The governments, particularly Indonesia, Malaysia, Singapore, Philippines, have been very in the forefront within their limits. But we don't see a mass movement of solidarity in Southeast Asia, as it happened in Europe, in the struggle against apartheid, the struggle against the Vietnam War, and now, okay, over the invasion of Ukraine by Russia, the people in the United States, Europeans, all rising up in protest. But situation in Myanmar is, yes, not a foreign invasion, but it is done by none other than the military leaders in the country. And the situation is, at least you can say, as bad as in Ukraine, and not with a physical devastation caused by in Ukraine by the Russian army, but the human suffering, the human toll on people of Myanmar, on the Rohingya, has been extraordinary, verging on what we could probably call a genocide.
Yes.
Okay.
I see Christine Hakim. I'll get back to you, Prisia, but I'm going to ask Christine Hakim to ask a question. Thank you. I know you're in the middle of shooting a big movie in Toraja, if I'm not mistaken. So I appreciate your taking the time out of the movie set to say hello to our good friend, Ramos Horta. Please, Christine, if you have any questions.
Hello, Papa President, His Excellencies. I'm happy to see you in a good shape.
Thank you.
I have a trick question for you. Maybe it's too much, Dino.
Let's take two. Yeah.
Two. Okay, I have to cut it off one from three. Yeah. So first of all, as I know you, you rather enjoy your life of a free man who admire a lot of women, but I heard that now you run for the president again in Timor Leste. It's a surprise me, but I know it must be something in your mind, and maybe you can also explain to us, because I know I'm sure, because for example, like Malaysia, you know, when Mahathir Mohamad on the 98 years old, he ran again for the prime minister because he saw maybe the country is in danger. That's why even that his health is not really the capacity to become a leader in the country, but he has to. So do you think there is also similarity that you see Timor-Leste in dangerous with the lack of the leadership?
Well, thank you, Christine. Running again for president was not on my plans. I never thought about it. Because after 10 years being disconnected from formal institutional politics of Timor-Leste, I was already getting used to it. I was always engaged with my country. In many ways, I always try to help the government, help the president, the government, or help communities as much as I could all these years. But I was doing already too many things. First with the United Nations, three times. I was first Under Secretary General and was sent to Guinea-Bissau. Then I was president of this high-level panel on UN peace operations, very challenging and stimulating. Then Secretary General Antonio Guterres invited me to be a member of the high-level board on mediation. But even on that high-level board on mediation, I was getting tired of it because it was incredibly amount of troubles. But I did, and I did many other things. So I was used to. But in 2006, it was Shanana who for me to serve as prime minister when the then prime minister resigned. Then in 2007, it was Shanana who called me to serve as president. And I ran for office in 2007, finished in 2012. And now, again, it is Shanana, our leader, a father, the real father of this country. And you all know in Indonesia, you all know Shanana. And he called me again. Because of the particular situation in the country today, I said earlier in my introductory remarks about how the current president, outgoing president, has breached the sacred principles of our constitution when he took upon himself powers that normally would belong to in a presidential system. So that set in motion a chain reaction on many other violations of constitution by the president, spill over to the parliament, then cause economic stagnation. Of course, then we had COVID. The government was incapable of stopping the economic collapse of our country. And although we had no reason, because unlike other countries, Timor-Leste has some $20 billion in reserves for a population of a bit over 1 million. So can you imagine, we are 1 million and we have $20 billion in reserve. If we were like 200 million, you know, Indonesia 270 million, but let's say 200 million, multiply that and you will see the reserve of Timor-Leste. And yet the government has been spending as never before by previous government, and the economy sunk to minus 8%. So that's why Shanana and the people in general angry and frustrated, and that's why we also have so many candidates and I'm one of them, and that's the reason I was not planning until the day before the decision made by the CNRT Congress to choose a candidate. I was hoping that it would not be me, and if they had chosen someone else, I'll be very happy. And it doesn't mean I wouldn't want responsibilities. I probably would join the government if I would prefer to join the executive branch as a minister or as an advisor or whatever. But Shanana asks you to serve, a bit like in Indonesia, if Bung Karno asked someone to serve in the cabinet in those years, or in South Africa, Mandela asked someone to serve. Well, you have a moral responsibility to the leader and to the people.
Okay. Let me throw you a couple balls. I'm going to go back to Christine and Prisha. But I want to ask you this question. You mentioned about Ukraine, and I'm sure we're all shocked by it. Yeah, we in Indonesia thought Russia would never invade Ukraine because it was just a bluff, right? Mm-hmm. He just wanted to intimidate Ukraine, but not actually invade. But we were all caught off guard with that event. Yeah, I'm just wondering: do you think now the world is entering a new era where the strategic tussle between the West and Russia, and to some extent China, is going to go to the next level, and the level that is rather for long term and difficult to undo? Yeah, so is that era coming now, right before us? Yeah, or am I too alarmist? Yeah.
Well, first, I would say the weakening of the multilateral system, of security, of collective security system, has been been dismantled already for the past at least 10 years. With particularly with the war in Syria, where complete failure of global leadership to address. All the major powers got in, major and the regional powers got involved in the conflict in Syria. From the five permanent members and the others, and regional powers like Turkey, Saudi Arabia, everybody got involved in many serious ways, pouring in billions and billions of dollars into the conflict in Syria. And then you have a Yemen, a far worse situation than happening in Ukraine on the humanitarian front. More than 100,000 children starving, millions and millions of people for which WFP has appealed over the years for assistance, and yet there was never enough money for the people of Yemen, never enough money for the people of Syria, and then you have the tragedy of post-American presence in Afghanistan. 25 million Afghans depend on food aid from WFP, and they have not been able to raise enough money. So on top of this, you have now Ukraine. And I personally didn't think that Putin would invade. One thing is plain bluff, or I use the expression when I gave a talk recently, brinkmanship. You know, the theory, the concept of brinkmanship is what? Is a leader, a major power, threatened to go to war, but then he stopped at the edge, on the abyss, before jumping into the abyss. Well, Putin apparently went beyond pure brinkmanship. Catastrophic for Europe, catastrophic for the world, but catastrophic for the United Nations. Remember the UN collapse with the League of Nations. The League of Nations prior to 1945, the creation of the Five World War II, the League of Nations collapsed for similar reasons. So we see, and then of course there are the implications, the sanctions imposed by the United States and by Europe and other countries, well, will have a consequence for the world economy. Dollar could collapse, and we did. Many countries that depend on the US dollar for trade and so on. It was unthinkable, you know, until a few weeks ago, that Europe would enter another major conflict, would be involved in another major conflict after World War II, after Bosnia. I wrote an article many weeks ago before the Ukraine invasion by Russia in Wall Street International magazine. And I tried to say that at the time I was saying something that right now they are talking about. Europe, United States have to understand Russia's legitimate security concerns. Remember in the 60s, Khrushchev with Fidel Castro installed Russian Soviet missiles in Cuba. 2 minutes, a missile from Washington. President Kennedy issued an ultimatum. You withdraw this missile or I bomb. Khrushchev, Fidel Castro back off, and the missiles were taken away from Cuba. So the United States was legitimately concerned with the installation of offensive weapons very near to American borders. Of course, the Russians are equally upset, angry with the expansion of NATO into the what Moscow considers to be the legitimate security interests of Russia. And that this has to do with world power politics. A superpower, which Russia is, if not an economic superpower, it is a military superpower. They have a sphere of legitimate security interests. You cannot simply have a hostile military alliance moving closer and closer. That's absolutely normal. How to handle it? Oh, this is a different matter. Putin, you handle it with the invasion of Ukraine. So my argument at the time was better that Ukraine remain a neutral country, not joining any military bloc. There are experiences in Europe of that. Switzerland is the oldest neutral country, but Sweden is a neutral country. Finland, probably one best example is Finland in relation to, in the past, to Soviet Union, now to Russia. And fortunately, this I wrote maybe 3 months ago. Right now, the president of Ukraine is talking about Ukraine doesn't have to join NATO. I would advise President Putin seize on this opening by the president of Ukraine immediately before situation gets worse for Russia and for Europe.
Thank you. Thank you. That was a very important statement. I promise Prisha and Christine 2 questions each. So I'm going to go to Prisha to ask her question. And then immediately after, Christine Hakim. And then Mr. Ramos Horta will answer both questions. Yeah. Prisha, please. Yeah.
Hi. Yes. Hold a minute. I was just reading about your tagline back then, back there, Timor-Leste, hard lessons from the past. And I heard that you, back then, you escaped from, nearly escaped death from some gunmen shot at your residence. Is that right?
Yeah.
Back then. And what did you think about it? And like, I mean, this is not like the experience that everyone would, you know, would experience themselves. Did you forgive the man who shot you, or did you make any particular oath to God when you thought you were dying, or how? Because this is like really hard lesson from the past.
Yes. Okay. Yes. Thank you. Let me ask Christine also to ask your question, and then Pak Ramos Horta can answer both. Yeah. Unmute, please. Christine, unmute.
Okay, then. Simple question, Bapa President. And what makes you hopeful in the troubled world?
What makes you hopeful in a very troubled world that we have?
Yes. Today?
Okay, so those 2 questions, yeah, please.
Yeah.
Could you, Christine, repeat the question?
What makes you hopeful in a troubled world?
My hope for this troubled world.
Yeah. Why are you optimistic and hopeful despite all the troubles that we're facing? Yeah, I guess that's the question. Please.
The first question by Tricia, I guess in relation to the violent incident attempt at my life in 2008. I understand that's the question. And it was it flow from our political security crisis in 2006, a crisis in relation to which I had absolutely nothing to do with in terms of creating the crisis. And I don't want in this forum to blame anyone. On this, we had a security crisis, and there was a group of armed elements from the army who had deserted. And a group of them came to my house early morning. I was already out. I went out jogging, walking with my body exercise. And when the main leader, I don't want even to mention his name, he entered the compound, he disarmed my security guard in the compound at the gate, disarmed another one. Then a third security man from the army inside the compound saw who he was, shot him like a professional sniper from Eastern, shot the intruders, who obviously with a hostile intention. I was out, I heard the shooting, and I came back immediately to the house because we knew it was coming from the house, and I was worried about the people living in my house. And that's when I was shot near my house. And I survived miraculously. The doctors indeed did fantastic work. I went to Darwin, incredible professionally, not Darwin, Australian doctors. I flew back on the, I was 2 months absent in Australia, Darwin. I came back. There was investigation, prosecution, sentencing of those involved. They served, I don't remember how long, but very, very short. And I pardoned them of using presidential prerogatives. I pardoned them of, otherwise they would have stayed in prison for 15 years and so on. And I was even criticized for pardoning them of, partly because they, some people say I'm weakening the justice system. Well, my argument is always justice has to be also compassionate. And I understand the causes of what happened to me, because I had nothing to do with it. I was totally, you could say, innocent. And in fact, the people who shot me, I was involved with them in a dialogue, trying to get them to surrender and return to the army. And and I was told by doctors and the others that I should not stay in the same house, that I would have a nightmare. I said, well, I'm not going to stay anywhere else. I'm staying in my house. And I continued then to do a normal life then and today. And so I continue answering question from Christine. God, I already forgot Christine's question.
What makes you hopeful in today's world?
Yeah. Okay, sorry, Christine, it's no offense. No, your question is very important. Let's say our people here in this country of mine, of ours, waited, fought, died, survived, fought again for 24 years. You have to have an incredible faith. You have to have an incredible willpower, resilience, to every day, every year, every day. You think that things are going to change, that one day things will change. And so you have to, the last thing anyone facing challenges is that you should lose is hope. If you lose hope, well, then you go into despair, you go into surrender. And you surrender your dignity, your dreams, and so on. So then you turn, we turn to the international situation. Well, that's, I'm a bit less optimistic because not only because of Ukraine, but because I've seen the last 10 years or more, the deterioration of the international situation. the incredible weakening of the collective security system. Look at the UN Security Council. We have five permanent members. They have this privilege of being permanent members. Not able to resolve Syria, not able to stop the war in Yemen, and NATO and the US collapse in Afghanistan, leaving Afghanistan in a total disaster. And of course, the Taliban have responsibility because of the way they have behaved in the past and are behaving. Well, very little the Security Council can show that it deserves to be called the Global Security Council. So in view of that, you cannot be very optimistic that, of course, the UN is not a power in itself. The UN is a combination of goodwill of powers. If there is lack of goodwill by member states, the Secretary General cannot be blamed for failures. So the only positive thing that I see in our multilateral arrangement is that at least the UN being there with all its agencies, you have UNICEF, WFP, WHO, you have a UNDP and other UN bodies. Well, look at Afghanistan, look at Yemen, Syria. You see the flag of the UN. If the UN is not able to resolve the conflict, at least they are saving millions of lives. Of course, through also the goodwill of countries that contributed to funding and providing food and medical supplies to these UN agencies. So let's strengthen at least these humanitarian and development agencies that are the only hope or the only mechanism, the only instruments that the international community can do and use to assist people in situations like Afghanistan, Yemen, Syria, and now in Ukraine. And other than that, I don't know. I cannot blame, of course, the US president and the others, because Putin started this war unnecessarily. Russia is a permanent member of the Council, it's a powerful country. They could have waited more pressure, talk with the Ukraine leadership, because the current president of Ukraine is, I never been to Ukraine, but from what I read, he's a very decent human being. He inherited Ukraine, an extremely corrupt, one of the most corrupt countries in the world. And he has tried to change the situation, to make Ukraine a lively, transparent democracy. In the midst of this, the effort by the current president of Ukraine, Russia invaded. But I don't also agree that I don't also agree with approach by US and NATO countries. You know, why you have to expand NATO into the borders of Russia? And NATO, with due respect, well, didn't achieve much in Afghanistan. And the US, NATO, after 20 years, had to leave, defeated by the Taliban. And because, yeah, they were defeated. And now getting, so I understand the feelings of Ukrainians, the Baltic states, Poland, having been dominated first by Nazi Germany, the Holocaust, but then by Soviet Union for 50 years, where they want a security umbrella that can protect them. But I would think that the best precedent, the best model, is what happened with Sweden, Finland, Austria, and Switzerland. Well, Sweden was neutral during World War II, was very poor before World War II, one of the richest today, was never invaded by anyone, because a powerful military force, powerful air force. It is not a member of NATO. Finland, much smaller than Sweden, right at the border with the giant Russia, never invaded by Russia. Switzerland, hundreds of years of neutrality. So why not apply the same model to Ukraine? For this, I said many weeks ago, fortunately now, the president of Ukraine is talking about it. And I hope that NATO and the Americans don't put pressure on the Ukrainian president in what he is saying, that Ukraine does not have to join NATO. And I hope that Putin is wise enough to immediately seize on this olive branch offered by the president of Ukraine.
Well, you know, Mr. Horta, I think if history should make you a president again, I think you're going to be your own foreign minister again, right? You may have a double job, or your foreign minister is going to have a hard time, having you as a president, because he will certainly be a foreign policy president. But I don't want to close this unless I ask about China. You know, every seminar about geopolitics in the region always mention China. Yeah, China is a big player now. It's definitely one of the biggest factors in the future projections of many countries, including for Indonesia. I'm just wondering, from your viewpoint, how do you see China's role in the region, including Timor-Leste's relationship with China? I understand that China is one of the closest countries, at least economically, to Timor-Leste. Yeah. So any comment on that? And after that, we'll close the session. Yeah. Please.
Yeah. Thank you. As president, if I'm elected, and obviously always in a partnership, active partnership, and with the government and the parliament, among priorities in our foreign policy, in my thinking, of course, number one is ASEAN, Timor-Leste membership, expanding relations with ASEAN countries, build more on the relationship with Indonesia, particularly on the economic trade investment front, expanding relations with Australia in all the areas that we have cooperated. I would like to see the Timor-Leste economy and the Australian economy and the Indonesian economy more integrated, with support from the two countries, Australia and Indonesia, and of course beyond. But I would like to see Timor-Leste expanding relations with Republic of Korea, Japan, and China. And that is to the benefit of Timor-Leste and to the region, but also with the European Union. We have exceptionally good relations with the European Union as an institution and with countries, namely Portugal, Spain, UK, Germany, Italy, France, etc. All the European countries in fact. Of course, we have a fantastic relationship with Portugal, so that will stay. But also with the Portuguese speaking community, CPLP, which is made up of five in Africa, Brazil, Portugal, and that is to the benefit of people. And you're continuing an initiative that Nombo Chanana, our leader, he was the one who started the G7 Plus, the Fragile State Initiative, that is now a dialogue partner of the UN and many other multilateral bodies, which involved Afghanistan, and other countries in the region, but particularly in Africa and the Caribbean. Caribbean is Haiti, is member of it, under the leadership of Shanana and the Secretary General of G7 Plus, Dr. Elder Costa, based in Dili and in Lisbon. The G7 Plus is a Timorese initiative that has gained international reputation. So all of these will continue. But absolutely necessary, the next 5 years, we focus on the economics of the country, how to eliminate extreme poverty, child malnutrition, how to make Timor a more inclusive society in terms of wealth distribution, make it more equitable, how to further promote gender equality, not only in speeches, but actually empowering women not only in politics, but in economics, because the independence of women economically is what assures them their true role in the leadership of the country. At the same time, try to expand our relationship with China and the United States. Timor-Leste will not take sides in big power rivalries. China is, obviously, everybody knows, a global power. It's not yet a global military power, but it's a global economic and financial power. 30, 50 years ago, if Chinese economy meltdown, no impact even in Southeast Asia. Today, any economic breakdown in China, I hope it will never happen like it happened in the United States in 2008, 9, 10, 11, with the subprime. But if anything like that happened with China, it would be catastrophic economically for the world. China has to deal with the issues of Taiwan and Hong Kong, particularly, and of course, South China Sea. I hope that China as a superpower that wants to be respected, it is respected by the way it uses soft power approach. Don't rush into militarizing the South China Sea. I would propose that that countries bordering South China Sea enter into dialogue, freeze their respective claims on maritime boundary, and look at a joint initiative for all the countries, first to preserve the South China Sea, avoid militarization of the area. If there is need for exploitation of resources there, like fisheries, they should do it jointly in agreement. Leave the maritime boundary limitation for much, much later. The former president of China, Wu Jintao, from 15 years ago, he was saying this. Leave the South China Sea will be resolved maybe in 30 years from now. Well, resolve it in 30 years from now. China cannot do the mistake of Russia in regard to Taiwan. China has to show to its neighbors, to the world, that is a true superpower with wisdom, using the Confucius, the 5,000-year wisdom of China to resolve its problems. And that's not only Taiwan, not only South China Sea, North Korea problem, the China-India border problem, global dispute, China-India rivalry. So it is actual nightmare, the situation in Asia, because Asia is the most nuclearized region of the world, not in terms of the amount of nuclear weapons, but in terms of countries that possess nuclear weapons. China, India, Pakistan, North Korea, all have a nuclear weapon. In Europe, you have only two, Russia, France and the UK. Then you have Russia and the United States. In Asia, two men with nuclear weapons and very close to each other, border each other. Very dangerous. So I would hope that wisdom prevail and for the best, the betters of Asia, that China look at the catastrophe of Ukraine and does not resort to military force to resolve the issue of Taiwan. But China has to be respected by the United States and by others. Europeans, Americans are right in speaking out on human rights violations, but do not appear to lecture too much the Chinese, because, well, the Chinese always fight back and remind about the Opium War and how every Western country invaded China, enslaved China. So you only raise up the nationalism of the Chinese society.
Well, this has been a fascinating discussion. I know we can keep it going for another hour, but I want to thank everybody who has stayed. You know, we're about 40 minutes over time. We were supposed to end at 6 o'clock, but I couldn't pass the opportunity to ask you all these questions. I want to thank Christian Hakim, Prisha, for asking two questions, two close friends of Ramos Horta. Ambassador Yasoja, thank you for staying with us. Ambassador Lopez, Yaroslav, my stake partner, Ambassador of Afghanistan, Ambassador Faizullah, and many others. So really, and of course my wife, who I don't know where she is now. I think she's at a cafe someplace. Thank you for joining this really deep and rich discussion. And we wish you all the best, Pa Ramos Horta. You are an inspiration to us all, even to your former enemies such as myself, right? You are an incredible human being, and like I said, you are the best son of Timor-Leste. Please send my best to Pak Senana Gusmao. I think he must be around someplace in the building, and everybody who's in the same room with you. I think there's an audience of your friend from Timor-Leste in the room. Yeah? Wish you all the best, and we will wait for what happens on Saturday. But like I said, whatever happens, your being in the election race makes the election a lot more interesting and raises the quality of the Timor-Leste elections. Thank you once again, my friend, and I hope to see you soon. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Pak Dino Patijalal, for moderating today's discussion.
Yes.
Now, we'd also like to once again thank Dr. Jose Ramos Horta for today's very interesting and insightful session. And also, of course, a big thank you to our distinguished guests, excellencies, and audience worldwide who joined from start to finish. Ladies and gentlemen, today's session is available for rewatch on FPCI's official YouTube channel at Secretariat FPCI. And with that, we've come to the end of our discussion today. So once again, thank you everyone for tuning in. Stay safe, and we hope to see you again in our future events.
Thank you.